The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 18th chapter. Jesus also told this parable to some who trusted in themselves that they were righteous and despised others. Two men went up into the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee stood and prayed thus with himself, God, I thank thee that I am not like other men, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week. I give tithes of all that I get. But the tax collector, standing far off, would not even lift up his eyes to heaven, but beat his own breast, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I tell you, this man went down to his house justified, rather than the other. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, but he who humbles himself will be exalted. Now they were bringing even infants to him that he might touch them. And when the disciples saw it, they rebuked him. But Jesus called to them, saying, let the children come to me, and do not hinder them, for to such belongs the kingdom of God. Truly I say to you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God like a child shall not enter it. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Holy, gracious, and heavenly Father, we thank you for touching our hearts with the gift of your word. For it is your word that brought forth this day. It is your word that brought forth this gathering through the gift of your spirit, sent from ages ago through your Son to your disciples, and through the cloud of witnesses year after year, a millennium after millennium, to us even here today at this midday. We pray now that you would bless us and that you would help us with that same Holy Spirit. We pray that you would bring light into the darkness of our hearts, bringing with it the gift of confession and the gift of forgiveness that comes with it. Bless us as we hear your word and know your will through it, and through also your spirit, give us strength to do your will in the world. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. So have you ever been going through your week and really wishing for a weekend? I mean, you're working like a dog. We're here midweek, and it seems like, you know, just Friday is just so far away. Have you ever wished for that weekend? And when it got here, and then the Friday comes, Friday, and then you have Saturday and Sunday worship, and then what do you say at the end of Sunday? Man, that went by way too fast, huh? Never thought ever crossed your mind. Anything else that you can think of, any experiences in life that you can think of that have gone by way too fast? I can think of just one general thing. Anybody ever had a vacation? And had a vacation that just went by way too fast. You said, man, that was way too short. Man, I didn't get to everything I wanted to get to. I've had that experience. Now, believe it or not, I have not just had this experience from the pulpit, but I have actually been where you're sitting, and I've actually thought a sermon went by too fast, if you can imagine that. Present company excluded. I've actually been in the pulpit, and the word is planting its seed in the heart, and the Spirit's doing its work, and the sermon, that's all? That just went by way, way too fast for me. Oh, there was something that every weekend, every single worship service that we have here, there is a part of the worship service that just, for me personally, as not just as a pastor, but as a disciple of Christ, it just goes by way, way too fast. And it was even there in our liturgy that we just did. I mean, it's an open book test. If you take out the liturgy, I got it highlighted here kind of in orange so that I can remember it. That little part in parentheses, right? What's it say? Silence for reflection. Anybody else think that goes by way too fast? I mean, there have been times at the Sunday service where I'm serving or I'm preaching, and one of the other pastors is doing the confession and forgiveness, and we get to that part, and they start to say, "Most merciful God," and I really want to tap them on. Can you wait a second? I'm not quite done reflecting yet. It just goes by way too fast. So as we continue through this Lenten season, as we're reflecting on the spiritual disciplines of Lent, the gifts that God gives us to use to draw nearer to Him, we reflect this week on the gift of the discipline of confession. So just from the lessons that were read that I had the blessing of picking, I just want to go through just maybe a couple of little bullet points about what the lessons say about confession and what that can do for us as a spiritual discipline as we continue on through Lent. Number one, we see that confession happens when we are in prayer to God. Now, if I were a good pastor, I would have had the lessons to give out to everybody so it could be an open book test. But suffice it to say, in that gospel lesson, there was only one person doing a confession there. If the lessons tell us in some way that confession happens when we are praying to God, who was the Pharisee praying to? If you read himself, it says it very clearly there in the Greek. It says the Pharisee was praying to himself or with himself. So it is safe to say the Pharisee was not making a confession. He was praying not to God, but to himself. He wasn't so much confessing, which means to admit guilt or wrongdoing. He was doing more professing, stating what he knew to be what he thought was righteous about himself. He didn't have a need of change. There was no confession. He was professing to God and anybody who would listen what he did that was so righteous in the sight of God. He's making a list of professing about what he does well. And as far as the need for change, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. That's what we see from the Pharisee. But the tax collector stands far off. Won't even go near to the Holy of Holies. Won't go near where he's allowed to go to there in the temple as an Israelite. Won't go near, but stands far off. It becomes abundantly clear that there is a difference between these two men who are praying. And the tax collector is the one who is seeking God. But how can we tell? Just from that gospel lesson, how can we tell that the tax collector is truly seeking God? It's because he seems to be aware of God's presence. And isn't that what the nature of prayer is? Is to simply be aware of the presence of God. So if number one, confession happens when we are in prayer to God, confession also happens when we're aware of his presence. Because when God's around, when we're aware God's around, things just kind of change a little bit. The story that happened to me several years ago, I had already been ordained a pastor. I was up in Ohio visiting my sister up there, and we went to Sunday worship there to place a pastor friend of ours from growing up. We go there, and I'm dressed, not in the owl, but I'm in my collar. I'm going to Sunday service, and we leave there, and my sister, anybody do CrossFit? Anybody heard of you? Seriously, Maureen? Okay, we'll talk after service. CrossFit, okay, good for you. Okay, keeps my clinic full, by the way. We go to her CrossFit gym, and there's a gentleman there who's one of my sister's friends, and when you dress like I am, what do they think? Okay, here's Tori's brother, the priest. And so we're there, and one of the gentlemen had this shirt on that apparently I found out afterward had some kind of obscene language on it. Because when the caller walked in the room, what happened? I kid you not. Guy didn't know me from Adam. But God walked in the room. The awareness of God's presence walked in the room, and his heart was pricked. Confession happens when we are aware of the presence of God. We can tell the tax collector is aware of God's presence because he is cut to the heart by his sin. He knows the realities of his sin. He's not deceiving anybody. Everybody knows what he does. And yet he's there telling, having the courage to tell the truth to God about who he is and trusting in the forgiveness that comes only from a humble and a contrite heart. That's what Psalm 51 says. So confession, prayer to God, happens when we're aware of his presence. Number three, confession brings about a change of heart. That's what happened for the tax collector, not because of his work, but because of the work and the promises of God Almighty. That he went down to his house, what? Having been justified. Not by his own works, but by faith in the one who is gracious by nature. That is the God of Israel. That is the God that we serve. Gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. So confession brings about that change of heart, a justification of our hearts that is a gift from God himself. And that is only possible because we are here gathered around God's word. Knowing the darkness that sin, I mean, it's just kind of pointless for me to sit up here and name all the ways we can be in darkness, but to know that reality and the gift of the light, that word that is what? A lamp to my feet and a light to my path. That word that brings light into the darkness that is our hearts. And when that light comes in and scatters the darkness and the forgiveness comes and our hearts are cleansed, now we have a new life. Now we have a different life where our actions don't flow from guilt. Our actions don't flow from shame. Our actions flow from joy. I mean, okay, we're not allowed to say the A word in Lent, right? But we can say the J word, right? We can have this new life that is born of joy. It's not a have to respond to the gospel. It is a get to. Confession brings about this joy. Oh, you forgave me. You would do that for me. You would give your body for me. You would bring me that light. Oh, what a joy. What a relief. What a blessing. So confession brings about that change of heart. That is not it's not a requirement to respond to the gospel, but it is a response. A response that is born out of God's joy. Absolute joy to forgive. That's what fed Jesus, right? That is what gave him joy. When he was traveling up through Samaria and he's tired, he's been traveling, the disciples say, Jesus, stop and get some food. You guys say, no, guys, I got food you can't see. My food is to do the will of the Father. So as dark as it seems, it is God's joy. To let Jesus bear the cross. Joy not for his death, but joy that his death brings life for us, the ones made and created in his image. That tax collector is cut to the heart. He knows the darkness of sin. He knows a number of different things from how the Pharisee is praying. That tax collector knows his sin. He knows his guilt, and he knows his shame. So when those come in life, when the guilt and the shame of sin come to bear, and it's not a matter of if they will, but when they will, where are you going to go to get rid of that weight? You ever had the weight of guilt on your conscience? Where do you go? Where's David go? Did you hear that psalm lesson, the pastor? Did you hear that? I mean, when I hid my sin from you, when I didn't confess it, it was like the heat of the day. We live in Florida here, right? I mean, summer's coming, right? And the dog days of summer and the heat and everything. When I held on to my sin, when I tried to hide it from you, it was like the weight of it was on me. But then I said, David, I'm going to confess to the Lord. And then, I mean, what did the psalm say? And then you forgave the guilt of my sin. Oh, you want to talk about a burden lifted. You want to talk about a joy of confession, lifting the weight of shame and guilt. That is God's joy. From his heart to our heart, at the absolution, the entire forgiveness of all of your sins when you turn to me and lay yourself bare before me. That's an act of trust. And maybe that's the last thing here, is that confession is both an act of, it's both a gift of faith and an act of faith. And those are both gifts from God. We know our sin because of the light that is the word that shows us our sin. But we also know that that light has come into the world. It's not just the light like from up here that can show me if I have a cut on my finger. It's the light that comes into the world to touch that wound and to heal it. It's that word made flesh that is Jesus. So when the sin and the guilt and the shame are there, it's an act of faith to confess that to God. It really is. Because what's the other word for faith? I mean, it's the same word in the New Testament Greek. Faith is synonymous with one word. It's T, trust. Faith and trust are, trust is faith in action. When we actually do believe that we can confess to God and we can trust that he will forgive, not out of obligation, but out of joy. It is his desire. He has more forgiveness waiting for us than we dare to ask for. And so I guess the one other thing that confession brings is it brings a change. Brings a change into our hearts. I mean, I almost wonder if that's really the toughest part of confession. It's not laying ourselves bare before God, but it's the fear that we might actually have to change. It's why we maybe try to hide it from God. But confession it is meant to bring change, a change of heart, and that changed heart brings changed actions. That is, changed actions come from a changed life. That is seen in confessing our sins to God through the Lord Jesus Christ. So we see in the tax collector some of the greatest sins, I mean, you could ever think about. I mean, not just the tax collector, but I chose that psalm lesson for a reason. I mean, when you think of the great characters of the Old Testament, I mean, David's one of them, right? I mean, he is the apple of God's eye. He's the one that's chosen to have the king that would be Jesus, who would come to reign on his throne forever. But there's a couple of things that David had on his record. Anybody remember that gal named Bathsheba? Yeah. Now, he goes, you know, he's out up on the roof when the king should be out, with their armies, leading battle. He's at home, and he sees Bathsheba, and, oh, that looks kind of pretty. And you know what happens next. It's like a great soap opera, right? Okay. Husband comes home. Oh, Uriah, go home, sleep with your wife. No, David, you're at war. My king's at war. I'm not going to do that. Okay, now go send him out to the front line to be killed. You don't think David knows about sin? When Nathan the prophet came in, that's going to be Psalm 51, where he shines the light on David's sin. Adulterer! Murderer! Great a sin can you get? Where is David going to go for that? He'd already written Psalm 32 by the time he wrote Psalm 51. David knows where to turn. There's only one place he can turn, and that is to trust in God, that he is gracious and that he is by nature gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. So I pray blessings for us all in this Lenten season, that this confession that we do each week, each day, each weekend are not just words from our mouth, but in awareness of the presence of God, bearing our souls to him, trusting in him that he is all of those things, that he is the one who forgives more than we are willing to ask. I pray that blessing of the gift of confession for us all this Lenten season in his holy name. Please take a few moments to meditate on the word and the will of God. Our hymn of the day will be found in your green hymnal in your pew racks, number 654.
Red
hymnal. Thank you. Please rise. Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Please kneel or sit as you are able.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.